So this is joint work with Adam Kurpisch and Sam Lebanen, both from Izia in Lugano, Switzerland. So I'm going to talk about what is called Lasserre or sum of squares hierarchy. And this is a very brief introduction to Lasserre hierarchy. And in 1999, it was introduced this sum of squares proof system, which is a real proof system. And it was shown by Shore, Parillo, and Lasserre independently that this is automatizable by using STP. Okay. And this is a systematic procedure for getting increasingly tight relaxation that is used among the best available approximation algorithm. So here, if you, I will not give a full literature. If you're interested, there is a web page that is also maintained by Nikhil Bansal and also Monique Laurent. You can find a lot of papers. So, okay, so there is this very important result this year that James already talked about, that for max CSP, it gives a sort of optimal approximation, in the sense that if you consider only STP relaxation of certain sites, the Lasserre sum squares hierarchy is optimal. And so the interest around this algorithm is also because it's a sort of blind optimal approach, at least for this max CSP. So what I'm going to talk about is some weak points, so it's the other side of the coin. So, yeah. So, but before doing that, I will introduce the Lasserre sum squares hierarchy in a less conventional point of view. So it's not usually presented in this way, but it is completely equivalent to this way. And it has a very intuitive meaning, what I'm going to present. So let me first say that this is, let's say that this is your linear program. So you start with an integer linear program, you relax it, and this is the linear relaxation. And you're not happy with this linear relaxation because it has large integrality gap, let's say. And you want to make it tighter and tighter. Okay, good. So I'm going to present the Lasserre hierarchy in this way. So first of all, what is an integer solution? This is just a partition of variables in two sets. Let's say set I, that is the set that of variable that take value 1. And the remaining ones are going to take value 0. Okay? So and then I introduce an indicator variable, that is yi, which is just says 1. It means that all the variables in I get value 1. And all the others 0, and 0 otherwise. So this is so we have an exponentially many number of these indicator variables. But I will not care because I'm going to talk about the lower bounds. So even though it's exponentially size, but we can always reduce to polynomial size. But I will not talk about this. And then you see these are the linear constraints of your linear program. So there are m of them. And with this notation, I say that this is the value of the constraint, of the left-hand side of the constraint. When you plug in all the variables in I, and they have exactly value 1, and all the others 0. Okay, so this is the value. So now, if this is equal to 1, and the solution I is a feasible solution, it means that this value has to be greater or equal than 0 for all the constraints. Far so clean? Okay, very good. So what is the first constraint in the Lasserre hierarchy? Well, it's a very obvious one. So the sum of these indicator variables has to be equal to 1. So you want to select one integral solution. Okay, so good. Okay, so let's go ahead. So now, so this is an indicator variable, right? But what is the integral solution? It's a vector, right? It's a 0, 1 vector corresponding to set I. And this is exactly this vector that I call it Zi. It's a little bit more. It's the integral solution in the lifted space. Okay. So what does it mean? It means the following. So this is the formal definition. So it's a vector. It's a 0, 1 vector that takes value 1. So it's indexed by sets. So if the sets J is inside I, then this is equal to 1. Otherwise, it's 0. So this is the integral solution in the lifted space. Okay, very good. So this is a vector. And if I multiply the vector by the transpose of the vector, I got a rank 1 matrix, which is PST, right? Very good. So now, if this is an integral solution, so this is, it could be 0, 1. So this is a rank 1 matrix. And if I multiply yi by this one, I got another, I got a rank one matrix again, that is PST, because this is 0, 1, and this is PST, and so this is PST. So this is a valid constraint in the integral solution, and if I sum up, I got a valid constraint as well. So what you see here is a valid constraint in any integral solution. Okay, good. So what happens with the constraints? Well, if this is a valid constraint in this solution, a feasible constraint, this is non-negative. So if I multiply this, that is non-negative, 0, 1, this is non-negative, this is a rank 1 matrix, so this is a valid constraint in an integral solution, and this is also a valid constraint with a very intuitive meaning. And this is the third type of constraint in Lasserre. So what is Lasserre hierarchy is this set of PST constraints. Okay, so now the size of these matrices basically determine the level of Lasserre. The largest is the lifted space, then the largest is the level of Lasserre. Okay. Okay. So, and there is a very fundamental property. I'm only going to talk about 0, 1 integral problem in this case, linear integer, linear property. And this fundamental property says that at level n, any feasible solution is a convex combination of feasible integral solutions. So, so let's say that the projection gives the convex hull, the integer convex hull. Very good. So the first argument of this talk is about what are the hardest formulation for Lasserre. And I'm going to define what does it mean hardest formulation for Lasserre. So so as I said, so if you are at level n, you got exactly the 0, 1 convex hull. So the hardest formulation for Lasserre, in my definition, are those LP such that if you go a little bit before, so at level n minus 1, so the projection of the Lasserre is strictly larger than the 0, 1 convex hull. Okay, so these are really the hardest one. So the first question that you can ask yourself is, is this set empty or there is one element? And this is known that there is at least one example of this, and this was proved by Cheung in 2007, probably. And I will talk about this later. Okay. So the first result that I say is this one. So I characterize, I give if and only if conditions for an LP for being the hardest for Lasserre. Okay. So what does it mean? The theorem says that DLP is Lasserre hard or Lasserre hardest if and only if this set of conditions are satisfied. I'm going to describe this set of conditions are very simple to interpret. So so first of all, the constraints have to be what I call single cutting vertex constraint. So what I mean is that imagine the hypercube. So if this is hard for Lasserre, all the constraints must have the following structure. And the structure is that they cut only one point of the hypercube, only one. If they cut two, then it's not hard. Okay? And this is explained by the first two conditions. So if you take any integral solution, there is only one integral solution that makes the constraint unsatisfied. So this becomes negative, and so this is negative. Okay? And for all the others, it's strictly positive. Okay? And this is the last condition, which gives some numerical conditions of the constraints. Okay? Okay, this is a necessary and sufficient condition. If they don't satisfy this, then it's not hard. It doesn't survive at last. So the simplest hardest problem for this problem is exactly what is called mean knapsack. And as I said before, Cheung in 2007. So this is the mean knapsack problem. So it's defined as follows. So you have to sum up xi times a parameter p, a number, an integer value, that has to be greater or equal than 1. And of course, this is a 0, 1 problem. And you want to minimize this objective function, which is just the sum of the variables. Cheung proved that for large p, the integrality gap is this one. So it's vanishing with n. Okay? But by using the sufficient and necessary condition that I showed you before, you can prove something much stronger. So basically, you can prove that the integrality gap of this mean knapsack is unbounded. So for any k, it's just sufficient to set up p sufficiently large, and you get an unbounded integrality gap. From the proof, sum of square proof system, it means that the sum of square proof system is not able to prove something stronger than this inequality. Yeah. Whereas what it must be proved is that this summation must be greater or equal than 1. Okay. So this is the simplest case. So now I go ahead with a second result that I will show in this. I will show a very hard tractable problem. So this is a frame that I picked from a talk, very nice talk by David Storer. You can recognize him here. And so in this talk, it says, so in the red area, there are all the intractable problems. Okay. In the green area, there are problems that are tractable by Lasserre, low level of Lasserre. And this is this yellow area is there are the tractable problems, but are intractable for Lasserre. Okay, and it also says something interesting here, that is the sum of square barrier, that is this one from green to yellow, is something that we can hope to understand. And this is one of the goal of this small contribution of this talk. And it also says that basically the only known problem that he knows that is solvable in polynomial time, but is not captured by Lasserre, is maximum matching. But even though it's not captured, the approximation is very good. Yeah. I show you another problem that is solvable in polynomial time for which the integrality gap is unbounded. And so this is a natural tractable problem that is intractable for Lasserre. And this tractable problem can be solved in n log n time. But even though you go to level square root of n, the integrality gap is unbounded. Okay. And this tractable problem is the following one, is a scheduling problem. So so we have n jobs. Jobs have processing times. And each job has a deadline. So you want to schedule this job, and if a job comes after the deadline, then you pay 1. Okay? So you want to minimize the sum of late jobs. Okay? This can be solved in n log n time, but if you analyze a very natural linear program for this this problem, plus the objective function as a constraint, so it's even more stronger, the integrality gap is unbounded. Okay, good. So short sketch of the proof, but I will skip it because I want to talk about the third result in this as an overview without too many details. Here I analyze, basically, I want to exploit symmetry. So so it's usually considered a technical challenge to analyze SDP. Yeah. And there are very few techniques that are available. And most of the known integrality gaps comes from the work of Grigoriev plus gadget reductions. Mm-hmm. And in particular, I'm going to talk about a result that has been proved by Grigoriev independently also by Monique Laurent about the convergence of Lasserre to the cut polytope in the complete graph. Mm-hmm. Okay, this is a result that has been used yesterday by James. It was the final ingredient of his proof. So for showing the exponential lower bound on the sides of the SDP relaxation. Okay. It was really the last step. Okay. So what this result says is that in n over two rounds are not sufficient for finding the integer cut polytope. And so the proof is involved, and it requires a lot of nice mathematical tools like association schema, hypergeometric series, and so on. And so, so for example, Ryan Donnell asked for giving, let's say, a pleasant proof or a simple proof. Simple proof for this one. I don't know if I match his requirement of being pleasant, but Let me make this. But it's a different proof. How does it work? So first of all, we prove a sort of a meta result, and these results apply to for every solution that is maximally symmetric. What does it mean maximally symmetric? It means that the value of each variable depends only on the set size. So, and if you have this this property, so if you confine yourself to all possible solutions that have this structure, okay, then the PSD conditions that is expressed in the form that I showed you before, which is this one, can be reduced to analyzing a set of inequalities that involve univariate polynomials. Okay, but these are very well-behaved univariate polynomials. In which sense? In sense that that are non-negative in certain intervals. So when you say that that these are univariate polynomials that are non-negative in certain interval, this is equivalently to say, it's exactly the same, to say that these polynomials are sum of squares in these intervals, because this is univariate. And the way to obtain this characterization is obtained by exploiting the symmetry as much as you can. What does it mean? So probably I still have 5 minutes. It means that assume that you have a matrix M, which is our moment matrix, for which you want to prove some PSD. And so since there is a lot of symmetry, this basically means that this matrix commute with permutation matrices. Permutation, to some extent, gives the idea of symmetry. So what does it mean that there are some permutation according to and this is the same. So this is equivalent to say that this matrix commute with p pi. But then by using this stuff, you can, so if you take any eigenvector, yeah, multiply by the same eigenvector here, you will get this one. This is the eigenvalue. But then if you multiply here by P, so this is a unit matrix, so cancel out, you will get here pi, so this is also an eigenvector. This is a very simple observation, very well known. But this, by using this very simple observation, so you can structure all the eigenvectors. Yeah? And then by using this very well structured eigenvectors, you multiply this eigenvector to this matrix, and this very well behaved univariate polynomial will appear, so with all the properties. So how do we use this fact, for example? So this is if and only if. So this is a polynomial that basically interpolates all these points with this property. Yeah? It's the number of levels of Lasserre. Exactly. Okay, so this is the equivalent condition. And now I'm going to use this condition for analyzing the max cut. So this applies to all the solutions. And let's consider an application of this, let's say, meta result that is max cut in complete graph. So we have a complete graph where the number of nodes is odd. And so what is the value of any solution? So if you pick omega number of nodes on the left, then you have n minus omega on the right, and this is the cut value, right? So what Grigoriev and Laurent proved is that for omega less or equal than n over 2, this is a feasible solution for the moment matrix. I rewrote the solution in the basis, in my basis. So this is doesn't look like a Monique Laurent solution just because I changed the basis of the solution, which is okay. But it's exactly this way. And this solution is basically implied by the constraint. So you don't have to think too much. You just have to, you have some constraints, and then you apply these constraints, you will get it. Okay. So the difficult part is to prove that this is a feasible solution. So that is feasible up to level T, where T is less or equal than omega over 2. And in particular, you see that for omega equal to n over 2, the Lasserre value is this one, whereas the integral value is this one, so there is a gap. Okay. So now we want to prove that this is a feasible solution. Okay, good. So now you realize that this solution is maximally symmetric because every value only depends on the set size. Okay. And we want to use this set of inequalities. Okay, good. So we want to prove basically that this is greater or equal than zero for any well-behaved polynomials, P. Okay? So what you do is basically you use the polynomial remainder theorem. You can decompose any polynomial in this way. You plug it inside. You do the calculation here. So you just open this summation. Okay? So here it appears the Q, and here it appears this constant term. But here the Q is of degree at most n minus 1. So, and this summation is just binomial summation. It goes to 0. Yeah? And here, this is a constant term. You can put it out. And this is a summation of the variables, which is the first type of constraint in Lasserre, which has to be equal to 1. Okay? So you got only this one. But this is the well-behaved univariate polynomial, which is non-negative in some intervals. So if you put omega equal to n over 2, then this is non-negative by the previous theorem. And that's it. Okay? And this we proved the Grigoriev Monique Laurent proof. I have also another application for this one, but probably it's more or less lunchtime. So maybe I have 2 minutes probably. So another application is that, so you've seen before this knapsack, right? And you've seen that mean knapsack is the hardest for Lasserre at level n minus 1, but P must be very huge. And I say must be, because it is necessarily a sufficient condition. If it is not huge, you don't have a gap. So a natural question that you can ask, there are two questions, is what happens if P is small? P small, so something equal to 2, for example. And the other question is that, okay, but this is a you start with a very bad linear program for knapsack. What happens if you start with knapsack covering inequality that have been introduced by Wolsey? And what happens there? So this is one case. The other case is if you introduce knapsack covering inequalities for this one, we get that this has to be n. And the other is that this is for every set of sides n minus 1. These are knapsack covering inequality. Okay. Here you realize immediately that the integrality gap of this linear program is 2. Because this says that you have to take at least 1. And here it's saying that it has to be strictly larger than 1. So for every set of sides n minus 1, it has to be larger or equal than 1. And here it says this one. So there is a feasible fractional solution that you assign xi equal to n minus 1. And this solution has an integrality gap 2. Okay. Now, natural question. What happens if you apply Lasserre here? What happens if you apply Lasserre here? And the result is that by using this meta theory, okay, you can prove that here the integrality gap basically remains P after almost log n number of rounds. And here the same, it almost remains 2 after log n number of rounds. So no help at all. Okay, this was the last result that I could present. And in case you are interested in discussing with me these Lasserre topics, I have a long, short visit support. And Fabrizio Grandoni has a PhD position in approximation algorithms, so ask him in case you are interested. This is Lugano. Just to attract people. And yeah. No, I don't want to compete with you. It's much stronger than my knowledge. Yes.
So when you want to find out this yellow area, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's a sample stock in formulation.
Exactly, yes. No. But for example, this n minus 1 level, you characterize all the problems that are hard, so that have a gap at level n minus 1. So you can push this more, n minus 2, n minus any constant, and so on. This will characterize the yellow area. So you find, so it's the other way around. So you find all the formulations for which the convex are. This is it the smallest step that I could do. So it's a starting. Okay. So Climatier talks about max knapsack. Okay, and this is min knapsack. Okay, so there is a difference, you know, because with max knapsack you can get a p-tas after constant number of levels, 1 over epsilon actually, it depends on the error. But min knapsack show a completely opposite behavior.